you all for coming. How many musicians do I have in the room? So how many people know what this is? Metronome, okay? So the first person who figures out what the symbolism is of a metronome will get a year's supply of magnesium. Close. Yes? No. In a manner of speaking, but that's not the answer I was looking for.
Please repeat the answer.
Time is ticking. Circadian rhythm. Heartbeat.
Balancing the body.
Balancing the body. We're getting closer.
Regularity.
But what? Yes?
Rhythm of the body.
Rhythm of the body. Going faster? What's happening to the body now?
Stress.
Aging? Why is it aging?
Stress.
What's causing this? What's stress going to the body? Soon you get to a year's worth of magnesium.
What was the answer?
Magnesium. As your magnesium level drops, life goes very fast. And you age quickly as your magnesium level drops. Magnesium loss is not a good thing. So when you're feeling like the world is coming at you, you know, a mile a second, that's magnesium loss. What's happening is your whole perception of the world is changing. Your hypothalamus is very magnesium dependent. Your hippocampus, very magnesium dependent. All of the aspects of the limbic brain live on magnesium. And that's your instinctual response to your environment. And so when the environment starts getting really agitated and scary, magnesium drops. So you raise the weight and the amount of magnesium in your body, and everything slows down. And you start to chill. It's that easy. Now, I focus on magnesium. I'm a simple guy. I was a hospital executive for 32 years and defended the allopathic code very faithfully. And then I had a transformation experience, a frozen shoulder, and was introduced to chiropractic. And my partner, Liz Erpenswick, over here, one of the great healers on the planet, in 2 weeks healed my body. Because I couldn't lift my arm, hand above my waist. And within 2 weeks, I had full rotation. And I went, what the hell just happened? Because I knew up until that point, and a yardstick of healing, 35 inches of it was allopathic. And the other inch was a bunch of wackos. Only to discover that, in fact, there are 35 inches of gifted healers out there. And there's a very different world out there. So welcome. We're going to talk about magnesium, maybe to the point of ad nauseum. How many folks here take magnesium every day? Wow, that's great. How many of you all take calcium? Not as many. So the word is getting out. That's a good thing. Linus Pauling said it best, every ailment or every disease is a function of a mineral deficiency. Now, either he was really smart or really lucky. I mean, the only scientist to get 2 unshared Nobel Prizes. I'm guessing he was really smart. And what I've learned is that there are a modest 18,000 enzymes in our body that are dependent on magnesium. which is about 80% of metabolism. And what you'll see in the literature, a lot of the websites, is between 300 and 350. And what they don't factor in is all of the various permutations of all those enzymes. It's staggering. And when you begin to realize how depleted our environment is and how depleted our bodies are, it takes on a very, very different meaning. Most of the people in this room are third generation of being minerally deficient. Your children are the fourth generation, and your grandchildren are the fifth generation. So we are Swiss cheese eating Swiss cheese. The food is hollow, and there's a lot missing in our tissues. And you cannot function effectively as a human being without proper minerals. It's that simple. The body runs on minerals. You've heard of the electrolytes? They're called electrolytes for a reason. They provide electricity for the body to communicate. The cell membranes like to talk with each other. And that's how they communicate about transferring minerals. So think of me as Toto. Who all has seen the movie The Wizard of Oz? It's a very poignant scene where Toto pulls back the green curtain. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pull back the curtain on the healthcare industry. And what I'm hoping is by the end of the hour, you're going to be begging for magnesium. Okay? That's my expectation. Okay. We all know the Earth is flat, right?
Yeah.
It's a blue marble, right? But for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, everyone assumed and knew, it wasn't just assumed, they knew it was flat. But all that changed in 521 BC when Pythagoras theorized and proved that, in fact, the Earth was round. And suddenly the intelligentsia around the world knew that the Earth was round. When did the common man finally accept that the Earth was round? Columbus? No, it wasn't Columbus. Close, though. Not Marco Polo. When Magellan's ship came back a year after he had died, and for whatever reason, it was that event that galvanized social consciousness, and they're like, my gosh, the world isn't that round. So that took 2,000 years from the time there was this discovery that the Earth was round to that it was accepted by the average person. Well, folks, we don't have 2,000 years. I don't think we have 2,000 days. My theory is that Homo Americanus is rapidly leaving the planet. And we'll see why in a few minutes. But I think we are, as a species, we are under attack. It's very serious. And in my simple way of thinking, the best way to deal with it is to replete your bodies with magnesium. It's not the only solution, but if you can take care of 80% of your problems, it's a good place to start. Okay, so what I'm about to share with you, it's like me telling you that a Santa Claus is just an idea. That your parents are fallible, and that the police and the priests and the politicians, they don't really have your best interests at heart. This was an ad from 1948. And at that time, it was the social consciousness that smoking was a good thing. If you look at the lower right-hand corner, there's a T in that model's face, and that was called the throat. I can't remember all the details, but they were really promoting the fact that this smoking was really going to help the throat. And that was the thinking in 1948. All right. Lao Tzu said it best many, many years ago. People would rather believe a simple lie than a complex truth. Right? Well, here's a litany of what's running medicine and nutrition. The cholesterol myth. Oops. Saturated fat, salt, calcium, vitamin D, sugar, mercury, and fluoride. Now I just picked out, what's that, eight? I picked out eight that are more entertaining than others. Well, I could have picked out 20. Do flies cause garbage? No. But they're attracted to garbage, right? Well, that's cholesterol. It's trying to repair a problem in your artery. Saturated fat got so distorted because of trans fatty acids. Salt. This is fascinating. Everyone's been taught and trained, you're eating too much salt. According to the Salt Institute, which keeps track of this, salt has been a currency for thousands of years. It's a very carefully measured and regulated substance around the world. We are eating and consuming one-third of the amount of salt in this country than our ancestors did before refrigeration. And yet we're not taught that. Calcium, we're going to talk a lot about calcium. But for those of you who do supplement with it, more than likely you're supplementing with what's called calcium carbonate, otherwise known as chalk, what our teachers used in class, and the body doesn't know what to do with it. We'll come back to vitamin D. Sugar myth. In George Washington's day, the average colonial ate 3 pounds of sugar a year. 3 pounds of sugar a year. I apologize. I didn't acknowledge some of the dignitaries here. Carolyn, where are you hiding? Carolyn Dean? Carolyn Dean is very special to me because she introduced me to magnesium via her book a year ago. So everything that I'm sharing with you is what I've learned in 11 months. And her book inspired me to read 18 other books and 350 scientific articles. So I'm dancing as fast as I can. But Carolyn, you shared that there was 150 pounds of sugar being eaten. It's actually 220. So it's 73 times what our colonial ancestors ate. The mercury myth, I think we know the story on that. And then fluoride, for anyone who really believes fluoride is good for your teeth, I have a used car, I would love to sell it. So here's the scorecard. The nutritionists, the physicians, and political pundits have been dead wrong about the first four, and they've been silent about the last three. So what I find fascinating is, given that scorecard, what is possessing people to consume so much vitamin D? We don't have time in this presentation to go into it, but let me assure you that vitamin D is not what you think it is. And there was a study done just this past year where this is the shell game they've been playing for decades. They measure vitamin D status. It's called they measure vitamin D. So they measure vitamin D with what's called calcidiol. It's sure it's vitamin D. And then what they do in these tests is they administer calcitriol, which is active vitamin D. Now this is a trick question. My bad. This is a trick question for the group. Trick question. What mineral?
Oh boy.
Is this getting any more exciting?
Of course
it is. What mineral does it take to convert storage vitamin D to active vitamin D. And so what's happened is the American public is so deficient in magnesium that the body says the job of calciol is get calcium into the blood. We need calcium in the blood. And when it's low, what the body is saying, got too much calcium in my blood. And that's what every vitamin D test is telling people all across America. And calcitriol's job is put calcium back into the bone. And you can't get to calcitriol without magnesium. We can talk about that in another meeting. Just know that there is a shell game going on, and it's absolutely in the literature, and it's very well reported that way. But they like to talk about vitamin D because they don't think we understand the difference between all the different vitamin Ds. So my theory is we have been misled, and we have been misfed. Misled and misfed as a nation for generations. And it started about 100 years ago. So think about what your grandparents and great-grandparents ate. That's the kind of food we need to be thinking about, and that's the kind of food we need to be eating. So as a former hospital executive, I knew that calcium was good for strong bones. Right? We've all been taught that. Absolutely good for strong bones. But what I can assure you is that it's also good for strong bottom lines. Calcium is very good for strong bottom lines for doctors and hospitals. Yeah. We'll go into why that's the case.
Morley.
Yes.
Can
we take
a bone
out of
the
hospital medicine? Legs. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Plasmoda. Okay. Calcium is drawn to an acidic environment. How would you characterize the American diet? Okay. So it loves it. This is great. Calcium activates the sympathetic nervous system. Right? That's what runs the freeze, flight, or fight syndrome. We know it as fight or flight. There's actually a preliminary step, which is freeze. When you have no magnesium in your body, you become immobilized. You freeze. Excess unregulated calcium is the problem. That's what causes inflammation. Inflammation is actually a very good thing. You need inflammation in order to have healing. But it's when it's not able to be turned off that it becomes rogue and becomes problematic. Inflammation is the basis of all chronic disease. There are three hormones that regulate, the three hormones that regulate calcium. Calcitonin, parathyroid hormone, and vitamin D. Another trick question. What mineral is required to activate all three of those hormones? Magnesium regulates the hormones that control calcium in your body. Have you ever been taught that before?
No.
So what you want to do is, for those of you who were taking calcium, if I were in your body, I wouldn't get near calcium supplements. And I can't get enough magnesium supplements. So the more calcium, the less magnesium, the better the business. Now you don't have to believe me. I've got lots and lots of journal articles that I can refer to, and this will be up on the website so you can get access to that. The literature is very rich with evidence and proof that this hypothesis that I'm sharing with you is in fact a fact. This is one of my favorite studies done. This is just a few years ago, talking about the potentially beneficial roles of calcium. I love that word, potentially.
Yeah.
Guess who funded this study?
Darius.
Thank you. And they had the audacity to list 11 conditions that were benefited by calcium. This was from 2003. To the women in the audience, I'm sorry. It's the best picture I could find of this. But we just can't, it's not a real count. But we can't get enough. We're obsessed with this. Our body is designed for a CalMag ratio of 1:1. How many of you have measured your CalMag ratio in your body?
I have.
Okay, how did you do it?
I'm a practitioner and I do a hair tissue mineral analysis.
Okay. And my partner Liz and I work with hair tissue mineral analysis all the time. How many people in the audience have ever done an electrolyte, an ionized electrolyte test? Okay, you have. Where'd you do it?
Labs.
Labs? Okay. Well, there are 5,000 hospitals in the country. There are 140 centers that actually have the equipment. It's one of the best kept secrets in America. But we're designed for 1:1. And so look at the food up there that is abusing that relationship. Dairy, 7:1, yogurt, 11:1, and acids, 300:1.
Yeah.
And when you have a lot of calcium inside the cell, it becomes very unhealthy. The cell does not like a lot of calcium. It needs a little bit of calcium in order to activate things, you know, activate muscles, activate nerves, but then it's got to get rid of it. But when there's so much in there, it can't get rid of it, that's when it becomes problematic. We evolved from the sea. At least that's what the evolutionary biologists would have us believe. Seawater has one part calcium to three parts magnesium. Do you think a thousandfold difference in that ratio might cause a problem in the human body? So we're taking an antacid. We are really flipping the electrical circuits big time. And that's where a lot of the problems arise, is that people aren't mindful of this calcium to magnesium ratio. And in my humble opinion, and the opinion of a lot of very learned scientists and clinicians, this is what rules our body, particularly as it relates to disease. One of Carolyn Dean's neighbors in Hawaii is Andrea Rosenoff. She did a wonderful study a few years ago looking at how this CalMag ratio is getting completely out of control. And there's a physician in Anchorage, Alaska. His name is Robert Thompson. Wrote a wonderful book. It's not too long. It's a paperback. You can read it probably in the afternoon. It's called The Calcium Lie. Trust me, calcium left unregulated is very problematic. Think of it this way. Magnesium is like yin and yang. It has beautiful qualities, but they're different. Magnesium allows you to play hard and rest hard. Calcium is like Jekyll and Hyde. And when it's in the presence of magnesium, it's a very wonderful substance. It's a very important substance. But when it's not around magnesium, it becomes Mr. Hyde. It becomes rogue. That creates a lot of disease. Now, Bob Thompson didn't come up with this idea on his own. He read about it from a gentleman by the name of Guy Abraham, who's one of the world's authorities on magnesium. He was an obstetrician at UCLA. Also an expert in iodine therapy and a variety of other. But he wrote an article called The Calcium Controversy. We have a booklet that's available, I think it will be outside the door here, and it's also available at booth 232. But this article by Dr. Abraham is in there, and I'm assuring you your jaw will drop when you find learn the truth about calcium. But Dr. Abraham learned it from Dr. Dahlberg, who was a biochemist in Scandinavia. And in 1960, he postulated and proved that osteoporosis was a magnesium deficient state. Period. There are 18 minerals and nutrients that go into making healthy bone matrix. 18. And what they picked out, whoever they is, what they picked out was the most problematic mineral when it's not in the presence of magnesium. There's no one in this room, I'm confident, because Liz and I have done about 300 hair analyses. Our mentor, Rick Malter, who used to be a clinical psychologist here in the Chicago area, has done 3,000 hair analyses. We've yet to meet someone who has a normal magnesium status in the body.
It may be normal, but then the calcium is all out of whack.
That's very
or
true.
Or something else is out of whack.
Right. Exactly right. So here's the truth. I'm just going to run through this real quick. Let's just leave it that the research is overwhelmingly against calcium as a source of solving osteoporosis. And now this is my favorite. Has anyone heard about the study by Reed and Bowling just this past week? Two team from New Zealand basically cracked open the whole issue with their, it's been a 3-year process. They've done a series of studies, one in 2010, 2011, just a couple weeks ago, basically saying calcium is a problem, and I'm being kind. But they refer to the fact that there's an 86% increased risk for heart disease for people who take calcium, and then have the audacity to say in the summary, what modestly increases the risk of heart disease. That is big pharma at work. And then my good friend, Pete Wisniewski, he's our status process rep, just shared this article the other day. In fact, the actual, Carolyn, you always take the credit for being my magnesium mother. Actually, Liz healed me, and Pete introduced me to hair analysis, because he's like, I don't know how to do it, maybe you can figure it out. So then we figured it out, and then I got introduced to you, so you took me to a new level. How's that? Yes. But Pete brought this article to my attention. There's a group called the U.S. Preventative Services Task Force. I've never even heard of it. 16-member panel, and they have a lot of authority, and they have reviewed 100 clinical studies and found no evidence that calcium nor vitamin D was beneficial for osteoporosis or breast cancer. If you go to the website, your jaw will drop because they go into excruciating detail about what the flaws are in the research. Again, either misled, either misfed. For those who want to really have a heart attack, if you're really committed to that, you want to move to Finland. Because they have the highest CalMag ratio in the world. We have time, we'll talk a little bit more about that. But what you want to do is, North Karelia is the community in Finland. It is the epicenter for myocardial infarct. If you're ever I guess that's called medical tourism. Go have a heart attack in Finland. So proof that calcium is good for business. In the last 25 years, what we've seen is obesity has doubled, diabetes has tripled, hospitalization rates have gone up fourfold, and despite spending $32 billion a year on statins, heart disease continues to grow at a rate of 85% over that 25-year period. Now, just to put it in perspective, So we spend $32 billion a year on statins. The entire NIH budget is $31 billion. And I did a forecast in 2008, which is actually why I became a wellness coach. A client had asked me to forecast what chronic disease was going to look like in 2025, and the numbers were so frightening, I realized you couldn't stay on the sidelines anymore. If you think people are sick today, it's going to get a whole lot worse in 15 years. Except those who take. Okay. Turns out the calcium and magnesium are antagonists. They're antagonists. And what happens is when you don't have magnesium, you get very flat and very hard, very fast. And that's how the body works. And the way it starts is usually the pineal gland. You start having trouble sleeping. Goes out of the thyroid, that starts to get calcified. There are only, you can relax, there are only 98 million Americans taking Synthroid. That's a third of the country. Synthroid is synthetic thyroid hormone. This means their thyroid gland's not working, which means we have a problem if a third of the country is not able to regulate their metabolism, which is what thyroxine does. And then it works its way down your body to calcify different things. So, stress. We all know about stress, right? We all feel it. We all feel that pressure. Stress is intimately linked to disease. We have a one-to-one relationship. And this was established by an endocrinologist from Canada. His name was Hans Selye. His first article on stress was in 1936 in Nature magazine. And he absolutely understood what stress was all about and published a book called Calciphylaxis. If you ever want to read a frightening book, you want to read Calciphylaxis. This is about the 15,000 animals that he experimented with causing stress to see what happened inside their body. And what he proved is that the tissues calcify under stress. It's the way the body works. It's the way we're set up. And his definition was, stress is not the opposite of relaxation. It is a non-specific response of the body to a demand for change. I don't know what that means. That's the most confusing definition I've ever seen. This is the guy that wrote the book. But we don't have to listen to him. He's Canadian. So let's come from an American's point of view. Mark Hyman. Mark Hyman's had four best-selling books. He's into functional medicine. I think he actually speaks a lot of truth. 95% of all illness is caused by or worsened by stress. But then he goes on to give, I think, the best definition I've ever seen of stress. It's the body's inability to produce energy for the mind to respond to its environment. So when you're feeling stressed out, it's because your brain can't get enough glucose to run all of its circuitry. For every molecule of glucose, and that's what the brain runs on, is glucose. For every molecule of glucose, you have to have 28 molecules of magnesium to process it. Trust me, that's a lot of magnesium. All right. Anybody dealing with any of these issues? High cholesterol, anxiety, depression? Okay. Some of us have all of it, right? But it turns out that all of those diseases, and Carolyn and I could probably list 25 or 30 more, but I just picked out 12 just for sport, but all 12 of them have roots and origin in magnesium deficiency. That surprise you? Okay, real quick. We all know about heart disease. We all know about metabolic syndrome. And maybe some of us have heard of endothelial dysfunction. That's the new sexy term for the problem. All have origin in magnesium deficiency. But you don't have to take my word. Again, I can share the literature with you. And I have 55 citations alone just for heart disease. I've got 350 articles categorized by 18 different diseases. But the most entertaining article I've read, the date was 1905. What I learned the most was a series of articles in 1932 to 1935, and then that was enriched by a series of articles in the 1950s. I don't worry about what the latest thinking is on magnesium. I go back to the source. So here's endothelial dysfunction. There are actually about a dozen different parts of the endothelium that break down due to magnesium deficiency. Again, 55 citations in just this alone. But this is, I think, noteworthy to share, is that this is the first time that I had seen it, where this was Jean Mayer over in Italy. You can say things like this in Italy. Magnesium deficiency is emerging as an inducer of endothelial dysfunction, low extracellular magnesium, and the need to correct magnesium homeostasis. The first time anyone had put it in print that this was the cause of the problem. But let's go down to the cellular level. You know, it's easy to say that at the artery level there's a problem. Let's go down into the cell. It turns out inflammation triggers oxidation, triggers calcification. Bing, bing, bing. We know it as heat, rust, cement. Heat, rust, cement. And again, brought to us by magnesium deficiency. Again, there are lots and lots of articles about this. But let's not stop at the cellular level. Let's go down inside the gene. And there are mechanism called heat stress proteins. Heat stress proteins 60, 70, and 90. I know it's going to be hard, but what do you think causes those proteins to flare up and start firing different directions? Magnesium deficiency, absolutely. At the genetic level, it's magnesium deficiency. And if anyone ever tells you that your condition is genetic, you can smile and say, please explain to me how it fits into the epigenetic model. And how your environment, the toxins in the air, the food that we eat, the thoughts that we engage in, how all of that is shaping the firing of genes in your body. Genes are not concrete. Despite what you've been trained. So here's a wheel of all the different diseases that people throughout the country have. And it's a pretty broad list, with every organ system listed. And what's exciting is each specialty of medicine has a different word for calcification. Arteriosclerosis, multiple sclerosis, arthritis, cataracts. Everybody has a different way of talking about it. And what they forget to tell us is that it's magnesium deficiency that's causing it. Again, lots of citations. It can't be that simple, right? That's what you're thinking. If it was that simple, I would know this. And if it was that important, my doctor would have told me, right? Isn't that what you're thinking? That's what I used to think. Calcification is lack of cellular energy. It's no more complicated than that. And I learned this from Jen Lewis, who runs a farming blog. Pretty interesting source. So what we've got is societal stress leading to organ stress, leading to metabolic stress, leading to cellular stress, leading to genetic stress. That's the chain. You feel the pressure, and it takes its toll. That's all from magnesium deficiency. Because there are 18,000 enzymes that can't fire properly when you don't have enough magnesium. This is the medical resistance to simplicity. It's not a popular drug, but yes.
How many people in the U.S. do you think are magnesium deficient? All of them?
Yeah. The studies, the literature would say it's 72%. My experience, and the experience of I think some of the clinicians, is it's probably 100%. Okay, Dr. Feld. We have the benefit of Dr. Jim Feld, who's an anesthesiologist here in Chicago. You mentioned that you share this with all of your clients, all your patients. Trust me, there's no one in this room or in this conference or in this city or in this country that doesn't have a magnesium issue. I'm pretty confident. And Dr. Abraham, that I referred to a few minutes ago, he wrote a monograph back in the 80s and said that if people would supplement with two parts of magnesium to one part of calcium, 50% of the hospital beds in the country would empty overnight. And I think he's right. Let's keep this in perspective. Magnesium is not a drug, it's food. But you can't reverse the metabolic dysfunction that you've got in your body by bulking up on magnesium-rich food. I don't care how good it is. And you can reverse it, but you've got to have a therapeutic dose.
With every meal?
Pardon?
With every meal, magnesium?
Yeah, depending on how you want to take it. Yeah. I mean, I bulk up at the beginning of the day, and I work with a form that allows it to just work its way through my body. But there are many different ways to do it. But yes, absolutely everyone needs to take it every day.
Every day.
And probably throughout the day is the best because it keeps the levels at a nice even keel. Dr. Fell, please don't take offense. This is as I see it. My oldest son, Matt, is going to get married in about 36 hours to a newly minted physician from Loyola. So you can imagine the excitement in our household right now. But I think what's happened is society's become so magnesium deficient, and the infrastructure that we're going into, the medical infrastructure, is set up not to recognize it. I think that's the biggest problem. Physicians are not taught about magnesium issues. It's not in medical school anymore. And there's no good testing. And Dr. Feld is unique in the sense that he's an anesthesiologist and regularly works with this with his patients. So we should all thank him for his dedication to that.
Yes. How did our country get so magnesium deficient? I guess that's the next slide.
Everything. You can't make energy at enzymes without it. We're going to run through this. The environment changed. It was magnesium rich for thousands, some would say millions of years. In the last 100 years, it's changed. And it's become very calcium rich and magnesium poor. And when you refine food, you lose the magnesium. When you use NPK, the magnesium can't get in the plant. When you use fluoride-activated drugs, which most are today, it binds up the magnesium. How does it get drained? These are the stressors that we're dealing with. Mental and emotional is the greatest stressor we live with. And all the others pale in comparison to mental and emotional stress, that constant din of, I didn't do it right, I've got to do more. Whatever the issue is, when you're feeling stressed out, if you take nothing else away from this talk, When you're feeling stressed out, picture a trap door opening in front of you and all of your magnesium dropping through it. And that's literally what's happening. Magnesium, that's the metabolic price you pay for stress. Your body gives up magnesium, it's hardwired into our bodies. And it's important and vital and essential that you replenish it all the time. I'm sure you can look at this list, and the booklet that we have will have a little test in the back of it. If it's so dire, why haven't these people told me about it? Well, turns out calcium's too good for the GMP. When you take 20% of the GMP, which is the medical industry, and you couple it with toxic food and pharmaceuticals, we're looking at about 40% of the GMP. Five-step plan, curb your stress. I know, it's easy to say, right? Heal your gut. Examine the importance of an ancestral diet. Yes?
Is there any reason why they couldn't add magnesium to the water supply?
They've been debating that for 40 years.
Get rid of fluoride?
Yeah. No, actually, don't you think it makes more sense to put fluoride in the water? We're talking about the GMP, man.
Yeah. Magnesium, you wouldn't be.
No, you're actually right. I appreciate what you're saying, but it's a hotly debated issue. Yes.
I've heard that since 1 or 2% of the population may get the laxative effect with magnesium in the water, that they won't do it. You can OD on magnesium water and cause yourself to lose your constipation. So it's not
yeah.
Are there parts of the United States that have high magnesium in the water, and do they have much lower rates of heart disease, etc.?
If you come to our talk on Sunday, Carolyn and I are giving a talk Sunday at noon. We'll talk about that.
Oh, okay.
In this room?
In this room?
I think Utopia D.
I think it's down the hall. Utopia D on Sunday at noon.
How many milligrams do you recommend?
A billion. I take 1,000 milligrams a day. If I were a woman, I would be taking 750. Well, hold on. Build your sympathetic tone. If you do nothing else, sit quietly for 5 minutes every day. Think about everything that you are grateful for. Think about all the blessings in your life. That one act triggers your parasympathetic nervous system, which is where the healing starts. Think about all that you have in your life. Even though you may have a lot of problems, think about the riches. That's when the body turns on. And when they've done PET scans of the brain, and people are doing that, the brain lights up like a Christmas tree. Absolutely changes the neurochemistry. And restore magnesium, water, as our gentleman over here mentioned, mineral drops. There are many, Liz and I work with 18 different forms of magnesium. We come down to booth 234 for Carolyn, 232 for Jigsaw Health, and we'll be able to talk to you about all the different forms. Salt is another great way, but it's gotta be the right kind of salt. Magnesium-rich foods, and of course, transdermal is another great way to bring magnesium back in your body. And I want you to have some fun. Next time you're with your doctor and he's going to give you some medication, ask him how this is reversing the magnesium deficiency. And remind him that physicians will give medications or supplements 4 times more often when the patient asks for it. So what do I think you should ask for? Magnesium, right. Is that simple? Are you kidding me? Right, I'm here to tell you, the ship has come in. Magellan's ship has come in. One of Milton Seeley's, one of the great authorities on magnesium, said, magnesium is the mineral of motion. Magnesium is the mineral of motion. So, who all wants to join our magnesium movement. For those of you who may be familiar with Les Mis, there's a very critical scene. I'm one of those Les Mis freakies. I've seen it 7 times. I can't get enough of Les Mis. And then I realized, oh my God, Les Mis. Misled. But who wants to join a magnesium movement? We want this to become a political movement, and we've created the Magnesium Advocacy Group. And we are going to get lots of people involved in this. We have manufacturers, we have clinicians. The goal is 12 months from now, 12 million people are going to know this message very clearly. 1,000 practitioners are going to be a part of this organization, and all 25 magnesium manufacturers are going to be part of this group. So we would love to have you be a part of it. Thank you for coming, and I appreciate your attention, and look forward to answering any questions that you may have.